Welcome to the video on classical convolutional neural networks. Classical CNNs can recognize a person, a car, a building, an animal, a bird, and also can distinguish among these as our eyes and brain do. We are very good in watching, understanding, learning, and inferring a scene. It happens in our brain so fast. To make a computer understand and interpret a scene, we need CNNs. These are complex mathematical models which are very good in finding patterns in images, recognizing people, understanding a scene, coloring a black and white image, assisting in medical diagnosis and surgeries, and even understanding a document. My agenda is to cover CNN timeline for classification, CNN architecture for image classification, 2D convolution, mathematics behind convolution, step-by-step convolutional neural networks, components of CNN, and also hands-on lab to create CNN architecture. So let's start with CNN timeline. CNNs are also called ConNet, which were initially developed by Lee Kern in 1989 to recognize handwritten digits. Later in 1998, Lee Kern proposed an improved ConNet architecture called LeeNet, which was more accurate in detecting handwritten digits. That's why it was quickly adopted by industry. One of the use cases of LeeNet was handwritten digits recognition of bank checks by utilizing MNIST dataset. It consisted of total 156 trainable parameters. AlexNet won the 2012 ImageNet competition, where ImageNet dataset had around 15 million high resolution images, 1.2 million for training, 50,000 for validation, 150,000 for testing purpose, in which 22,000 classes are labeled. It is very good for any object detection task. It consisted of total 60 million parameters. Then, in 2014, VGGNet was invented by Visual Geometry Group from University of Oxford. It was the first runner-up in ImageNet large-scale visual recognition competition 2014 in the classification task, which has significant improvement over ZEFNet, the winner in 2013, and AlexNet, the winner in 2012 ImageNet challenges. VGG16 has around 130 million trainable parameters, where VGG19 has 143 million trainable parameters. GoogleNet or Inception V1 was the state-of-the-art architecture at ImageNet large-scale visual recognition competition in 2014. Prior to its inception, most popular CNNs like LeeNet, AlexNet were just stacked convolution layers to deep levels, hoping to get better performance. On the other hand, Inception was a complex network. It used network-in-network approach to push the performance for image classification task. Network-in-network architectures use spatial multi-layer perceptron layers after each convolution to combine features before another layer. The 1x1 convolutions are really helpful in combining convolutional features in a better way instead of simply stacking more and more convolutional layers. Total number of trainable parameters in Inception V1 are around 6.7 million, which are pretty less than AlexNet, VGG16 and VGG19 with greater speed and accuracy. The most popular variant of Inception V1 is Inception V3. It was the first model to use batch normalization. It also used the factorization method to have more efficient computations. Batch normalization is a technique for training very deep neural networks that standardizes the inputs to a layer for each mini batch. This has the effect of stabilizing the learning process and dramatically reducing the number of training epochs required to train deep networks. Another interesting framework named ResNet was developed in year 2015 with model depth of 18, 34, 50, 101, and 152 stacked layer versions, in which ResNet 50 consisted of 50 layers of ResNet blocks, where each block has 2 or 3 convolutional layers. It has 26 million trainable parameters. ResNet was proposed by He et al., who had won the ImageNet competition in 2015. It solved the problem of vanishing gradients in deep neural network architectures by using residual blocks. In DNN architecture, network learns several low, mid, high level features at the end of its layers. Whereas in residual training, instead of trying to learn some features, it tried to learn residuals Residuals can be simply understood as subtraction of feature length from the input of that layer. ResNet does this using shortcuts or skip connections by directly connecting input of nth layer to some n plus xth layer. It has proved that training this form of networks is easier than training simple deep convolutional neural networks, and the problem of degrading accuracy is also resolved. Inception V4 was proposed in year 2016, which is similar to Inception V3, in which Inception block is combined with ResNet block, which is a complex in nature but utilize the advantages of residual block as well as Inception network with 53 million parameters. ResNext, proposed by Zhi et al. In year 2016, in which the concept of cardinality is proposed as an essential factor in addition to the dimensions of depth and width. Cardinality is the size of set of transformations around 89 million trainable parameters. Then in year 2018, squeeze and excitation network was proposed by Hu et al. They proposed a new block for the selection of feature maps that are commonly known as channels, preferably for object discrimination task. Other than classification task, convolutional neural networks are also used for object detection, image segmentation, pose estimation, and also activity recognition. In year 2014, 15, and 16 respectively, RCNN, FastRCNN, and YOLO, these pre-trained networks are proposed for object detection tasks. Now let's understand convolutional neural network architecture for image classification task. CNN architectures belong to the family of deep neural networks consisting of distinct stack layers to perform specific operations on provided input to get probability scores at output layer. On providing image input, CNNs can extract features from the image. Then these features are used for classifying the given image of one of the provided classes. Here the image of a green python is getting high probability score at output layer, therefore it belongs to a class of snake. Features are the building blocks of an image, such as edges, ridges, contours, patterns, colors, and their possible combinations. CNNs use convolution, max pooling, and fully connected layers to perform classification tasks. Let's understand each in detail. Let's first understand convolution operation. When a kernel is slided over an input image, we get a feature map. That feature map consists of some of the features of the input image. We can apply more kernels over the image, and then another feature map is generated, which contains some other features from the same image. So here we can see we get three feature maps after applying three different kernels over the image. Let's understand the mathematics behind the scenes. To understand the mathematics behind the scenes, let's first understand what are the three kind of images we are seeing right now. So the first image is a binary image. It contains black and white patches with the values 0 and 1 respectively. Another image is a grayscale image that contains intensity values between 0 to 255. Then the last image is a colored image. It contains three channels, red, green, and blue, where each channel ranges between 0 to 255 values. Now let's understand convolution operation. So here we can see two vectors A and B. Those are also called matrix of size 2 cross 1. Where there are two rows and one column. When we calculate a dot product of these two vectors, we get a single score in this form, a1 b1 plus a2 b2. This is nothing but a convolution of two vectors a and b. In a similar manner, we can also calculate a convolution of two matrices, where one matrix denotes the input image with different intensity values and another matrix denotes a kernel. In a nutshell, convolution is nothing, just a dot product of two vectors. Let's understand this with an image. So if we apply a kernel over an input image, on calculating इट्स डॉट प्रोडक्ट वी गेट अ सिंगल वैल्यू दैट रिप्रेजेंट्स अ पिक्सल ऑफ अ पर्टिकुलर इमेज. सो नाउ लेट्स अंडरस्टैंड स्टेप बाय स्टेप कॉन्वोल्यूशन. सो हियर दिस इज आवर कर्नल वेयर नाइन वैल्यूज आर देयर इन अ मैट्रिक्स वेयर दीज वंस कैन डिटेक्ट अ स्ट्रेट लाइन एज फ्रॉम एन इनपुट इमेज. वेन वी convolve this kernel with an image, we get a single value of a feature map. This is how the kernel will slides over the image and calculate a single value of feature map. This is nothing, just a dot product of kernel with the input matrix. And we slide with the different regions and we are getting different values of feature maps. These feature map values are actually the multiplication of kernel with the input to capture different edges of an input image. Okay, let's understand what is striding. So here we are seeing an example of a stride of 1 and a stride of 2. In both the cases, we are getting two different feature maps. Next is padding. In padding, we cover our input image with some zeros or reflection of the corner input values to generate a feature map of same size of the input image. So the relevance of striding and padding are like striding is used, normally we use the striding of 1, but most of the time when the input image is covered with uniform background, stride of 2 kernel is used so that convolution operation will only extract the useful features, whereas padding is used to keep the feature map of same size as input image. Now let's understand feature map calculation for any input image with any kernel size. Here we have a kernel of 5 cross 5 which is sliding over the input image with padding 2 and striding 2. So we apply this formula to calculate a feature map size where n out represent the size of a feature map. So we get 5 cross 5 feature map after sliding a 5 cross 5 kernel over a 9 cross 9 input image with padding 2 and striding 2. So next is max pooling layer, in which there is a padding of 2 and striding of 2, and we calculate the maximum value here is 11, which extracted here, whereas maximum value from this region is 13, from this region it's 6, and from this region it is 21. The relevance of max pooling is that it is used to get the most prominent features from the feature map, or we can say input image. So now let's understand how CNN architecture is created on a lab. To do this, I open Visual Studio Code. So here I've imported few packages such as NumPy for matrix manipulations, Keras to create a neural network architecture, then Keras.datasets import MNIST. This is our dataset, MNIST dataset, which has handwritten digits in it and their labels. Then I've imported Keras.models import sequential. Sequential is used to create all the layers of the model. We have studied in the video that there are three layers. One is convolutional layer, one is max pool layer, and one is fully connected layer. So we'll create these layers using this sequential. And then in the next line, I've imported dense, dropout, flatten, conv2d, max pooling 2d. So I'll explain each of these one by one when I'll follow the code. And then the other two imports we'll see when we'll process the code. I've included to ignore the warnings of depreciated libraries and few functions which are generated by Keras and its backend TensorFlow. So let's run this code. So it's running. There is no error. Now to prepare a data set, I'll write this code. Okay, num classes is equals to 10. This explains that we have total 10 output classes, and this is our input image. The dimension of input image is 28 cross 28. There are 28 rows and 28 columns. Input image of MNIST dataset. Then, because this dataset is included in Keras library, so it is properly structured dataset. So we can import these kinds of data set using dot load data function with these parameters. So here it is not required to use train test split function. We can directly use x train y train comma x test comma y test to load the MNIST data set. Now this is the use of K, which is KS backend from Keras import backend as K. So this is how we reshape the data set. First we look for if this is true, then all the images of the data set are reshaped for training and testing purpose. So this will check the format of the data, and if it is like this, then it will reshape it in this way. Otherwise, it will reshape it in this way. Now our data set is prepared according to our requirement. Now we are normalizing the value all the cells of a data. Here I'll check the shape of the data and train samples and test samples of the data set which I have imported. And also here in the last line, I'm converting class vectors to binary class matrices. Okay, y train and y test. So two categorical, what it will do, it will change those class vectors to binary classes. It means if the output is 9, then it will convert it to 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 8 times 0, and then at the last cell I'll write 1, which will present that it's the number 9. And if it is 2, then there will be the converted binary code will be like 0, 0, 1, 0, 0, 0, and so on. So at the third place, I'll place 1 because Python starts the numbering from 0. So let's proceed and let's run this thing. When we'll run, this will print the total number of X train samples, their dimension with channel 1. So it is a black and white, it's a grayscale image. So here the channel value is 1. And total number of 60,000 training samples and 10,000 10 samples are here. Now, next task is to build a model. So let's proceed to build our model. Total number of output classes are 10. And now the sequential class is used to create an object name model. The model is equals to sequential, like this. We'll create a model object and then we keep on adding our layers. First, I'll add con2d layer with 16 number of kernels of kernel size 5 cross 5 with the activation of ReLU function by providing input shape. And the next layer is con2d 32 kernels 5 cross 5 is the kernel size, activation function is ReLU. So if we will go back to our presentation, then here we have different layers, like these are convolutional layers. Now we are adding two type of these layers, one after another, with ReLU activation function, and 5 cross 5 is the kernel size. In our image, kernel looks something like this. This is a small square that is a kernel. So next is max pooling, where pool size is 2 cross 2. So this is a stride of 2 and pooling of 2. Then dropout layer is used. So this layer is special because it prevents the model from overfitting. Means some neurons would not fire. 25% of the neuron would not fire from the previous layer. Then I've used flatten to flatten all the neurons which came after dropout. Then we add a dense layer, and this dense layer takes 32 neurons stacked like this. Like we have a stacked column of 32 neurons. And after that, I use dropout, means 50% of the neurons will fire. And last is the softmax layer, the last layer where we get the probability scores related to each number of class. Total 10 classes will get probability scores. Softmax function, activation function is used to create probability scores. And then model.summary will print our output. Okay, let's run this again to see is this working or not. Okay, it's working. So let's understand this summary. So con2d5, this is the name of our con2d layer, and its a type is convolution2d. where the output shape is 24 cross 24 cross 16. It means total 16 feature maps we will get after applying 5 cross 5 kernel on the input image of size 28 cross 28. It means if we'll go back to our presentation and look where I have applied multiple kernels over the image. So yes, here. So here, when we apply a kernel over the image, let's play this video. When we apply multiple kernels like this over the image, we get a feature map. So like this, here I've applied only three kernels, but in the code we are applying 16 kernels like this over the image to generate 16 feature maps. So because when we apply kernels over the image without any adding any padding, then the size of the image gets reduced like this. So we are getting a reduced size output. So here I'm getting 24 cross 24 is the output shape after applying 16 kernels of 5 cross 5 size over the image. So if we'll put these values in this formula to find out n out, so n out value will be 24, where padding is 0 and striding is 1. Kernel size is 5 and input is 28. So then we'll apply this formula and n out will be 24. So now still how we are getting these parameters. So for understanding this, let's open this calculator. To calculate the parameters, actually we need to understand what we have done in this line. So we are applying 5 cross 5 kernel. It means total 25 values. It means 5 cross 5, that is 25. 25 values are applied. Those 25 are the weights. Those values are actually weights. Those are random weights generated by this con2d function. Then if we apply 25 weights, where each let's open our presentation also. Let's assume that this kernel, which is sliding over the image, is of 5 cross 5 size. It means total 25 values are simultaneously applied over the image. And when this is applied 16 times, how many parameters will have? So to calculate that, 25 cross 16. Now total number of values are 400. But how we are getting 416? Because when we create a neural network, there are weights and biases. So we have 400 weights plus 16, that is total number of kernels we apply, 16 biases. Then 416 is the total size of parameters in this layer. Let's understand second layer. So in the second layer, we apply con2d with 32 kernels of size 5 cross 5. After applying this, we get a feature map of 20 cross 20 with 32 channels. So let's calculate parameters this time. To calculate parameters, what we will do, we'll multiply 5 cross 5, that is 25. So let's multiply this. 25 cross 32 is the number of kernels we are applying. So we'll multiply this also. 32, that is equals to 800. So this we apply on a single channel of the previous layer. And there are 16 channels in the previous layer. So when we multiply this with 16, we will get 12,800 parameters. And what is left? That is 32 biases are left. This is total number of kernels we have. So now the total number of parameters are 12,832. Now we got the same number. Then next layer is max pooling. So in the max pooling layer, if we'll go back to our concept, so in the max pooling layer, we do not apply any kernel. We just capture the maximum value from 2 cross 2 window. So there we need no weights and biases calculation. And the size of the layers will be same here also. Size of total number of feature maps will be same. And in the dropout also, वी जस्ट प्रिवेंट फ्यू न्यूरॉन्स टू फायर. इट मीन्स ओनली 25% ऑफ द न्यूरॉन्स विल फायर दिस टाइम. सो देर इज नो चेंज इन नंबर ऑफ फीचर मैप्स एंड पैरामीटर्स विल बी जीरो बिकॉज वी आर नॉट अप्लाइंग एनी कर्नल ओवर द इमेज. नेक्स्ट इज फ्लैटन. सो फ्लैटन इज द कन्वर्जन ऑफ अ स्क्वायर फीचर मैप लाइक दिस इन टू अ फ्लैटन एरे. अ फ्लैटन एरे वी कैन अंडरस्टैंड इज समथिंग लाइक दिस. मीन्स वी विल हैव फोर ब्लॉक्स वन आफ्टर अनादर. सो आई विल पुट सम ब्लॉक्स हियर, देन फर्स्ट ब्लॉक, सेकेंड ब्लॉक, देन थर्ड ब्लॉक एंड देन फोर्थ ब्लॉक. सो नाउ वी आर कन्वर्टिंग आवर फोर ब्लॉक्स इन टू दिस लीनियर आर्किटेक्चर. सो दीज आर फ्लैटन न्यूरोन्स. विल कंसिडर देम एज फ्लैटन न्यूरोन्स. सो लेट्स फिल द कलर्स ऑल्सो, ऑरेंज, ग्रीन, ब्लू एंड येलो. सो दीज आर ऑल द न्यूरोन्स वी विल गेट आफ्टर फ्लैटनिंग दिस काइंड ऑफ फीचर मैप. बट हियर वी हैव फीचर मैप ऑफ साइज 10x10. द साइज ऑफ द फीचर मैप इज 10x10 विथ 32 फीचर मैप्स स्टैक वन आफ्टर अनादर. इट मीन्स टोटल नंबर ऑफ स्क्वायर्स और वी कैन से टोटल नंबर ऑफ न्यूरॉन्स विल बी 32x10x10, दैट इज 3200. आफ्टर फ्लैटनिंग द न्यूरॉन्स वी अप्लाई अ डेंस फंक्शन विथ 32 न्यूरॉन यूनिट्स. सो नाउ वी आर क्रिएटिंग सिंपल न्यूरल नेटवर्क आर्किटेक्चर. नाउ दिस इज आर फ्लैटन एंड इन बिटवीन आई एम एडिंग 32 न्यूरॉन्स दैट विल बी कंप्लीटली कनेक्टेड विद द प्रीवियस लेयर. मीन्स डेंसली कनेक्ट. एंड फ्रॉम दोज ओनली 50% विल फायर हियर. सो इफ आई विल कैलकुलेट द टोटल नंबर ऑफ पैरामीटर्स हियर बिकॉज वी आर कनेक्टिंग दिस लेयर विद द प्रीवियस लेयर, फ्लैटन लेयर. सो टोटल नंबर ऑफ पैरामीटर्स विल बी 3200 इंटू 32. लेट्स डू दिस. 3200 इंटू 32 दैट इज इक्वल्स टू 1,02,400 एंड these 32 will be added because these are biases. So now we'll get 1,02,432 parameters. And in the dropout, only few neurons will fire and nothing will change here, zero parameters. Then in the last layer, we have this dense function with a softmax activation function. So what it will create? It will create 10 number of classes which are connected with the previous layer. So to calculate number of weights here, what we need to do, we will multiply 32 with 10. 32 into 10, that is 320, plus total number of biases in this layer, 10 biases. Means 330 will be our number of parameters. This is how we calculate total number of parameters, and then we add all of these parameters here to calculate total parameters in the model. So these are trainable, all the parameters are trainable parameters. So this is our model summary. Now we understood it. Now in the next line of the code, we are providing 128 as batch size. It means a batch of 28 images will be sent one time to the this neural network architecture, means to this model. Okay, now we'll compile our model with the loss, categorical cross entropy loss. Okay. We'll include these things in the next video. What are their mathematics and functions? And then I'm using optimizer as Ada Delta. Optimizer is used here. So you can also study a few key points about these functions in the VS Code also. How to apply these functions. And then matrix is accuracy. So when we compile the model, then we can train it. To train a model, I'll pass xtrain, ytrain in the model.fit function with batch size of 128. Epochs are 1, verbose is 1, and validation data is xtest and ytest. So when we fit our model, it will take some time to fit. I'm running the cell again. Now one epoch I'm taking here. You can take more than one epochs. And here I'm getting accuracy and the loss during the training. Once the model will compile and all the data, and once the model will be trained with our data, we can test it. Till that time, let's understand this score. So we use model.evaluate to test our model, and this will test the model on x test and y test, and it will print the test accuracy and test loss. This is our training accuracy and loss, which is getting modified once the model is getting trained with the batch size of 128 images at one time. Okay, now our model is trained with the loss of 0.45 and accuracy around 85%. Validation loss is 0.72. It means this is our validation error, and validation accuracy is around 97%. So our model is trained with 97% of validation accuracy and 85% of training accuracy, and 45% training loss and 7% validation loss. So model is pretty good. We can test this model. So this is how we print the scores. Even we are getting the scores here also. We can print it using these codes. Now next is model prediction. So to predict a model, we need this predict function. So model.predict x underscore test 223. Let's run this cell first and check what model has predicted. So we can see the prediction scores are like 7.87 to 10 power minus 7, 9.9 to 10 power minus 1, 1.07 to 10 power minus 6. So all the powers are in minus. So 10 to the power minus 1 is the lowest power with the greater digit we have. So this is our prediction class. So threshold score will print 1 here, and this shows that our model is predicting 1 because this is what we got. So when we have converted our categorical variables to binary classes, we got vectors like these. And here this represents 0, this represents 1, this 0 is represents 2, then it is 3, it is 4, and so on. So all the numbers are 0 other than 1. So model is predicting x 2,3 as 1. Let's check our ground truth. Model x test 2:3 is, what is this? So to check this, we'll write this code plt.imshow x test 2.reshape. CMP dot CMP is equals to gray. So this is how we will get to know what we have passed. So let's see there, if this is 4, then what is it is here? There we get 4 as an image. Let's pass this image in the prediction. So we need to pass 4:5, and once we'll run this, we'll get predicted digit as 4. Let's test, because we have 10,000 samples for test image. So we can test any of them. Let's test what is 800. So we really don't know what is 800. That is 8. This is pretty good. So let's check 800 here. Is model predicting correct value or not? 801. And now it is predicting 8. That's good. We can check other values also. Like I'm checking some random value between 1 to 10,000. So let's say 837. This is some random value. So there we have 2. So let's test what model is predicting 837, 838. Let's check this. The model is pretty well trained, so it is predicting the right class, because we got our validation accuracy as 97%. That's why all the tests we have done are actually correct. So now in the next video, we will look into applications of convolutional neural network, and I'll cover some basics of loss function. Thank you for watching this video. If you have any questions, let me know in the comment section.